Everest erosion. Mount Everest has captured the imagination of the public. There's actually one U.S. presidential candidate that has claimed to have been named after the first European and possibly the first person to climb to the top of Mount Everest and make it back alive. Mount Everest, this is taken from Wikipedia, also known in Nepal as Sagarmatha and in Tibet as Chomolungma, is Earth's highest mountain. Its peak is 8,848 meters above sea level. That's recently been revised. In 1856, the Great Trigonometrical Survey of India established the first published height of Everest, then known as Peak 15, at 8,840 meters, or 29,002 feet. It was actually 29,000 feet, but they felt that wouldn't be believable, so they added two. The current official height of 8,848 meters, as recognized by China and Nepal, yeah, the legislatures get to determine how high the mountain is, was established by a 1955 Indian survey and subsequently confirmed by a Chinese survey in 1975. The 1924 expedition resulted in the greatest mystery on Everest to this day, George Mallory and Andrew Irvine. George Mallory, you may remember, made a comment about why am I climbing Everest? Because it's there. They made a final summit attempt on the 8th of June, but never returned, sparking debate as to whether they were the first to reach the top. They had been spotted high on the mountain that day, but disappeared into the cloud, in the clouds, never to be seen again, until Mallory's body was found in 1998 at 8,155 meters, or 26,755 feet, on the north face. That's the side facing Tibet. Tenzing Norgay and Edmund Hillary made the first official ascent of Everest in 1953. They were the first people to make it and get back and be able to say, yes, we made it. Mount Everest is part of the Himalayas, or sometimes the Himalayas. They're mountains between India and China, specifically between Tibet and India. They extend a long ways out, all the way out into, and, you know, there isn't a hard and fast cutoff here. You can see interesting things, the Ganges or Ganga River, as it's sometimes called, with one of the branches actually going through. Here's a air satellite photo with the countries outlined here, and Mount Everest is about here, but you can see the range goes all the way through, and it has something like, if you count this as part of the range too, which I think is fair, there are over 100 peaks that are higher than the highest mountain in the rest of the world, which is in South America. So we have the Ganges, and you can see the Khasi River going right through into the backside of the Himalayas. And we have the Brahmaputra. We're going to talk about those rivers, so I'm pointing them out to you. But it's very interesting because there's a whole bunch of other rivers that are there as well. You will notice that the Indus and the Brahmaputra almost come to the same point. The Indus running through Pakistan, the Brahmaputra running all the way around through and into the joint delta with the Ganges. And running into Bangladesh. But interestingly, although the Irrawaddy doesn't quite make it there, as you can see, the Salween River, the Mekong River, and the Yangtze River in China all come out to that same general place. In fact, if we go back, you can see how the how the terrain is folded like this. You'll see that in a couple of other places in the world. One of them is in Yugoslavia, and the other one is in Appalachia. And you see those long rivers that are going right side by side through separate canyons. It's just amazing how many rivers there are that go that way. And even the Yellow River starts there as well. Anyway, I'm going to ask several questions. Number one, what is Mount Everest made of? Number two, how long has Mount Everest been rising? Number three, how fast is Mount Everest rising? Number four, how fast is Mount Everest eroding? And the final question, why is there still Ordovician limestone on the top of Mount Everest? Well, that last question actually takes off of the answer to the first question. What is Mount Everest made of? The top is fossiliferous Ordovician limestone. In other words, it can be dated by index fossils. Whatever date you want to put to the Ordovician, that's the date of the top of Mount Everest. Just below that is what they call a yellow band of marble, which is apparently limestone that has been kind of heated and massaged around a little bit. And below that is granite and schist. Apparently the granite and schist were formed under high temperature, and some of that went up to the limestone just above it and cooked it into marble. But there's good limestone on the top.
Can you say something about limestone? Why is it so significant?
Well, we're going to get to that. First of all, I'm going to put the pieces in, and then we're going to play with them. Okay. Here you can see a very nice photo, which these people kindly allowed me to use it, mountainsoftravelphotos.com. And you can see the limestone on top of the marble. You can see the yellow band of marble. And right about here you can see the granite underneath the marble, all the way out to here. You'll notice in this mountain that's a little bit closer to us, you can see the same yellow band on top of it. Let's take another shot from Wikipedia, where again you can see the limestone and the marble. And what you see here is the hills of Tibet, and that one mountain that was sticking up, we're a little bit back from that, and so you can see it's now at a little bit lower elevation. Here's a shot from the south, kind of the southwest. And you can see that the top is not flat. It's angled off a little bit. And there's the yellow band granite. And here's the limestone yellow band. And all that up there is limestone. Okay. How long has Mount Everest been rising? Well, that depends on who you ask. And I'm going to give you two answers that kind of bracket it. Wikipedia or Himalayan Club. And the answer is somewhere between 10 and 55 million years. It used to be about 35 million, but there some of these, Wikipedia and National Geographic, are trying to put it as low as possible for reasons that will become obvious later. The Eurasian plate includes India. It's debatable as to whether it contains this part of Burma or not. That's the Eurasian plate up there, and this is the Indian plate. And the story that is told by Wikipedia is that the Indian landmass came and was hurtling up in this direction. At 38 million years, it was quite a ways from the continent. And then the real crashing took place probably 10 million years ago. The other site has India coming up, but this time by 55 million years, you're starting to get some collision. Remember that all of that material that is now mashed together had to be on one of these two plates. Either the Asian plate stuck out, or the Indian plate, or a combination of both. So the plate's bigger than what it is now. By the time you get to 45 million years, you have it really quite close, and there's quite a bit of mountain building. And by the time you get to 20 million years, you have a lot of mountain building. By that time, you're having a major collision. So you can take your pick. National Geographic kind of splits the difference, but shades it even more recent at the very end. They start out by saying India collided with Eurasia some 50 million years ago. Right there. Land crumpled and buckled upwards, the birth of the mighty Himalaya. So it's been going up for 50 million years. But the tumult wasn't over. A cataclysmic uplift 20 million years ago formed much of the present-day Himalaya. Wait a minute, I thought we started already. Okay, whatever. Yet they still weren't the dramatic peaks we know of today. About 8 million years ago, says geologist Mark Harrison, the present range, the really steep topography developed. Now, slicing nearly 6 miles, 10 kilometers into the sky, the Himalaya became the highest mountain range on Earth. So you read them, it really, really, really started about 8 million years ago, but it had been going on for a long time before that. So your mileage on that may vary. How fast is Mount Everest rising? Well, if you go back to that National Geographic article, it'll give you an answer that was pretty common. In 1994, researchers placed a global positioning satellite device on the South Col. That's a plateau below the summit, so it's not actually at the summit. Readings suggested that Everest grows 0.1576 inches, or about 4 millimeters, each year. And that's a very common figure. If you read Geology of the Himalaya in Wikipedia, it will tell you actually there's a lot more. Let me just do that again. Topographically, the belt has many superlatives. The highest rate of uplift, nearly 10 millimeters per year, at Nanga Parbat. So there's some place that it actually is raising 10 millimeters a year. If you look at the literature, it says 7 million, I think. 7 millimeters a year. And Xu et al. In 2000, in Earth, Planet, Space, had the southern Tibet, the average uplift is 16.2 plus or minus 7.9 millimeters per year in southern Tibet, suggesting that maybe it's been going up a little faster than that. Because Tibet's going up faster than that. But if you go to extremescience.com, Professor Brad Washburn of the Boston Museum of Science, the world's foremost mountain cartographer, and his team have calculated that the Earth's highest elevation is 29,035 feet. You may remember it was 28 feet before. Thanks to some engineering whizzes at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology who developed really light LIHTC gear, Washburn was able to hand carry a radar device to the top of Everest where it could be positioned to measure the actual height of the mountain underneath all that snow, which is about a meter, at least what they say. I haven't personally been there to check. GPS technology was also deployed near the summit. They also determined that the Himalayan mountains are still growing higher at a rate of about 2.4 inches or 6.1 centimeters per year. That's a bit more than 4 millimeters. That's twice as fast as previously thought. Wait a minute. That's 10 times, 12 times, something like that, as fast as previously thought. A growth rate of 2.4 inches or 6.1 centimeters per year doesn't sound like very much, but if you think about it, that means in the last 26,000 years, the Himalayas have risen almost a mile into the upper reaches of the Earth's atmosphere. Whoa. Extrapolate that back real quick, and it does seem like less than 10 million years, would you say? And then there's another website which says in May 1998, American mountain climber Wally Berg of Copper Mountain, Colorado, successfully made it to the top of Mount Everest and placed a global positioning system receiver within 18 meters of the mountain summit. 5 days later, another climber retrieved it. When the results were compared to data from other GPS equipment around the mountain, researchers discovered that Everest is growing taller at a rate of up to 5 centimeters per year. So there's apparently two different measurements that suggest that 5 to 6 centimeters is about right. Wow. Now, I found a place that looked wonderful, and it collected three measurements that you've already run into. And then just I'll summarize it. 1853, 8,840 meters, or 29.002 feet, 29,002 feet. September 1992, 8,848.82 meters, or 29,031 feet. Now, if you actually believe that, that's accurate to the nearest centimeter. And then finally, May of 1999, 8.850 meters, or 29,035.3 feet, exact to the centimeter. That's pretty impressive. Okay. Based on the results from the first GPS measurement, now this is why I'm a little leery of trusting this site. GPS measurements at the south saddle of Mount Everest at an elevation of 7,930 meters or 26,017 feet 4 years ago, the expert team concluded that the Everest massif rises at least 4 millimeters or 1.5 inches per year. Well, that sounds like our 4 millimeters that everybody's quoting. However, at a recent press conference, Bradford Washburn explained that the elevation of Mount Everest has not changed, but the mountain has been moving 3 to 6 millimeters, or 12 to 24 inches per year in the northeastern direction.
Yes,
4 millimeters and 1.5 inches. That should be 0.15 inches, I think. That's number one. And 3 to 6 millimeters is a bit less than 24 inches. So somebody is having trouble with math, and that's why I'm... And not only that, but you notice that they misspelled Washburn's name. So I'm a little bit cautious, but the numbers that I just quoted match everybody else, so I'm going to use them anyway. Maybe it's not exact to the nearest millimeter, but let's supposing that it is... you have 8850.00 minus 8848.82. That's 1.18 meters. Okay, now let's just do a little subtraction here. Well, first of all, May of 1999 minus September of 1992 turns out to be 6 2/3 years. 6 years, 8 months. Plus or minus, okay? 1.18, the difference here, divided by 20/3, happens to be 0.177 meters per year. That is, if you take those measurements as accurate, it's going up at 17 centimeters per year. Now the 6 starts to be a little more believable. Maybe it's even short. Well, let's. What about that original measurement? Remember 8840 way back in 1953, 8850 now. That's 10 meters. It was 1999 minus 1953 is 46 years. You can do that math in your head, I think. And 10 divided by 46 is 0.21 something, 217, I think. Close enough to 0.22 meters per year. That's 22 centimeters. That's even more than our original. Now, I will have to say that I'm not sure that we can trust that first measurement that precisely. It could have been off by 5 feet, 10 feet. Maybe even 20 feet. But it does look like the mountain is growing, and it looks like it's growing to where 6.1 centimeters is not an unreasonable figure, and to where 4 millimeters is getting a little hard to believe. But now let's ask another question. How fast is Mount Everest eroding? Well, how do you measure that? Well, there's a couple of articles that I'm going to bring your attention to. One of them is Olin S. M. et al. In 2015, Understanding Erosion Rates in the Himalayan Origin, a case study from the Arun Valley. The Arun Valley is over to the southeast of Mount Everest. And what they did was they measured how much beryllium 10 was in it, and they came up with 0.2 millimeters per year. I'm not sure, I'm totally convinced by that. But then there was Gabet E.J. et al. In 2008, Modern Erosion Rates in the High Himalayas of Nepal. And their methodology, by the way, you can get the article online. Their methodology was measuring sediment flux and solutes in rivers, which means you measure how much stuff is dissolved in the water, how much stuff is kind of floating around in the water, and they tried to estimate bed load. That's the stuff that's kind of slowly being pushed down the river, but not most of the time suspended. And in the Annapurna Manaslu region, which is west of Everest fairways, they were getting 0.2 to 1.1 millimeters per year. Perhaps the best study I've seen is Galey and Plantz and Nord in 2003, and their methodology measured dissolved material, sediment, and bed load, just like the other one, only now they measured it also. They measured silicon, aluminum, iron, and strontium isotopes and neodymium isotopes, which, because they do rubidium and strontium dating all the time, they're very good at measuring strontium isotopes. And they fairly well understand them. And neodymium isotopes the same way for samarium neodymium dating. And according to their measurement, they were doing theirs in the Ganges River and in the Brahmaputra River. The eastern Himalaya has a higher erosion rate, 2.9 millimeters per year, than the western Himalaya at 2.1 millimeters per year. This is likely the result of the higher runoff in the Brahmaputra Basin. The monsoons that come over tend to come and dump most of their water on the eastern side of the Himalayas. And so there's more erosion in the Brahmaputras than there is in the Ganges. And in one of their figures, figure 3, samarium and neodymium isotope compositions suggest that eroded material stored in foreland basins, Siwaliks, and that carried by the Ganga and Brahmaputra rivers in Bangladesh, mainly derived from erosion of high Himalaya crystalline. In other words, what erosion they're getting is mostly in the Himalayas and not from the Ganges Plain or runoff from agriculture or stuff like that. While rooting around in the literature, I discovered an interesting article by Burbank et al. Ignore the university. In 2003, decoupling and erosion and precipitation in the Himalayas. And the abstract can be gotten in Nature, and if you're a member of the university library, as I am, you can actually read the article. And they did their stuff on apatite fission tracks, which I'm not sure I would totally trust, but they seemed to trust it fairly well. And the interesting thing they found was that by their measurements, across a zone of about 20 kilometers length, spanning the Himalayan crest and encompassing a more than five-fold difference in monsoon precipitation, much more on the Nepal side than the Tibetan side, which kind of stands to reason. Significant spatial variations in geologic erosion rates are not detectable. In other words, even though one side gets a lot more rain than the other, the actual erosion is about the same. One of the things that people kind of attribute that to is that if the mountain is steep enough, it erodes anyway, whether you've run too much water on it or not, because either you get glacier erosion, or you just simply, the slope is steep enough that there's enough landslides that form most of the actual erosion. And interestingly, I found this article in 1961, Menard, Some Rates of Regional Erosion in the Journal of Geology. This is a long ways back. And the abstract was fascinating. I was able to get the actual article, and it supports what's in the abstract. The average rate of erosion of the Himalaya region during the past 40 times 10 to the 6 years, 40 million years. So they're operating under the 40 to 50 million year age of the Himalayas, is only 0.02% if you like, of the present rate. The fastest average rate observed is about 20 centimeters per 10 to the 3 years, obtained in the Himalaya region for the past 40 million years. Now that's about 2 millimeters per year. Point two millimeters per year. So they're measuring it quite slow. Not like the people who actually did the Ganges and Brahmaputra rivers. The proportion of sediment permanently lost from the continents to abyssal plain is Appalachian region 17%, Mississippi region 8%, and Himalaya region possibly 49%. And they make a comment, losses of these magnitudes cannot have occurred during much of the geologic past. In other words, it's being eaten out too fast, and this just can't keep going. Maybe earthquakes will make up for this somehow. As a matter of fact, and again, I apologize for the university, Mount Everest shrank as Nepal quake lifted Kathmandu. And again, this is on the internet. According to the early analyses, a region 75 miles or 120 kilometers long by 30 miles or 50 kilometers wide lifted upward by as much as 3 feet during the earthquake, said Tim Wright, a geophysicist at the University of Leeds in the United Kingdom. This uplift peaked only 10 miles from Kathmandu, even though the city was relatively far from the earthquake's epicenter. So Kathmandu, you may remember that there was a massive earthquake there, and Loma Linda actually sent some medical people to try to help to deal with the aftermath. That's one of the reasons why Kathmandu had so much damage, Wright told Live Science. The radar images revealed that some of the world's tallest peaks, including Mount Everest, dropped by about 1 inch or 2.5 centimeters. According to the nonprofit UNAVCO, a geoscience research consortium. That's because the Earth's crust relaxed in the areas north of the Kathmandu after the earthquake released pent-up strain. So, according to them, the earthquake dropped a centimeter. Well, the only problem with that theory that, you know, the mountain doesn't rise as fast as we think, and it doesn't in that sense, but the magnitude isn't very big. We're talking about a centimeter. The rate of growth is somewhere between 4 millimeters and 6 centimeters. If it's 6 centimeters, that was made up in 2 months. If it's 4 millimeters, that was made up in 2.5 years. Not a big deal. And the last earthquake like that in the region was in Kathmandu in 1934, so it doesn't happen very often. Now, for our last question, why is there still Ordovician limestone on top of Mount Everest? Okay, in order to understand that question, let's remember the answer to our other four questions. What is Mount Everest made of? How long has Mount Everest been rising? How fast is Mount Everest rising? And how fast is Mount Everest eroding? Now, what is Mount Everest made of? Remember, it's Ordovician limestone on the top, marble, and then granite and gneiss below. How long has it been rising? At least 10 million years, the conventional wisdom. Okay. How fast is Mount Everest rising? Well, somewhere between 4 millimeters and 6.1 centimeters per year. Maybe as fast as 17, but for now, let's not go there. How fast is Mount Everest eroding? Well, again, I would say our best guess at this point, given the information we have, is about 2.1 millimeters per year. So, well, how fast is Mount Everest eroding? Well, you see, it's 8,850 millimeters divided by 2.1 millimeters per year. That means you can erode the entire mountain off in, that's down to sea level, in 4,200,000 years. Well, how much could you erode in 10 million years? Which again is a minimum figure. 2.1 millimeters per year, 21,000 meters, or if you like, 21 kilometers. Once upon a time, according to this story, there were 21 kilometers of material on top of what is now Mount Everest. And all we have is that little bit of Ordovician limestone. Well, how fast has it been rising? Well, it's been rising at 4 millimeters per year, conservative. 2.1 millimeters per year erosion, so that leaves you 1.9 millimeters per year. That means that it should have gotten all the way from sea level to its present height in 4,700,000 years. If it's been rising faster than that, then you're looking at 145,000 years to go from ground level to the top. Now, there's an article by Jessup, which again is found on the internet, and I'm just going to show you one of their figures so that you can see what we're dealing with. This is the entire figure. And I'm going to enlarge this to the point where one pixel is one pixel on the screen. Enlarging more doesn't give you any more added detail. And you can see the top of Mount Everest has this stuff on it. Some of the other mountains do too. The thickest area here looks like it's probably less than a half a kilometer. So if you started out with a half a kilometer of this stuff on top, and we can erode 21 kilometers, why is that stuff still there? You can build mountains by continuing to renew them from below, but if you do, the top should be gone. So I put this to a friend of mine Uncommon Descent, in the midst of some comments that I think he was throwing Mount Everest as how did it get that high, how do we cover it and stuff during the flood. And so I commented, I understand your disagreement with the greatly accelerated rate of mountain building for Mount Everest in the past. The rates required by a short age theory are so much faster than current rates that we find it hard to imagine them. However, we still have a problem with the standard picture. if the rates of erosion on Mount Everest has been measured correctly at between 2 and 3 millimeters per year, that was the one article I showed you, and has been constant, and Mount Everest has been there for at least 35 million years, which was the lowest figure I could find then. You'll notice that it's gone down since then in certain websites. Then approximately 70 to 105 kilometers of material has been eroded from the top. One can keep renewing the material from the bottom, but in that case, the peak of Mount Everest should be granite and not Paleozoic limestone, as is currently observed. It is not clear why this limestone has not been eroded away, given the standard geologic timescale. And then he replied, the top of Everest doesn't erode by weathering. It's protected from the weather by permanent ice cover. It erodes by crumbling under the force of gravity. If you take two sheets of semi-rigid material and force them together laterally, they will relieve the strain by bending and breaking, piling the excess material upward. As the pile grows larger, it becomes more and more unstable until gravity causes it to collapse. The collapse doesn't necessarily occur from the top down. It occurs from the point where the strain exceeds the strength of the material. The lower portions of the mountains are under the most strain from the weight of the material above it. When the weight exceeds the ability to hold it up, the sides will collapse outward and the top will move downward, but will still remain on top. Look at how the World Trade Center collapsed on 9/11. The top of the structure remained at the top of the pile after the collapse. The bottom exploded outward while the top fell straight down. There's no mystery at all in there being marine sediments on top of Mount Everest. It's shielded from weathering, and collapse due to gravity happens in such a way that the topmost material remains the topmost material. So my comment back was, that's a fascinating theory of the mechanism of erosion of Mount Everest. Did you come up with that one on your own, or did you find that in a geology text or article somewhere? I just left it at that. Anyway, my take, Mount Everest has been rising for somewhere between 10 and 50 million years, according to the standard geological interpretation. Both erosion and mountain building are happening much faster at present than is compatible with that scenario. If one slows down erosion, the mountain builds even faster. It is difficult to explain why Ordovician limestone at the top of Mount Everest is still there with the present rate of erosion, regardless of what the mountain uplift is. If one speeds up erosion to catch up to mountain building, the problem of the Ordovician limestone becomes even worse. The existence of Mount Everest with its limestone cap is a major problem for standard geology. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn. Yes, comment. Yeah. Now, did I answer the question?
No.
No, okay.
Well, you did explain, and I thank you very much, but my ignorance of limestone. What is the difference between limestone and the other kind of igneous?
The stuff that's underneath?
Yeah, in other words, can you explain the nature of limestone? Where did it come from?
Well, limestone is calcium carbonate, usually assumed to be precipitated from water. And I would agree with that judgment most of the time. And the idea is that when it's precipitated from water, it also covers up some organisms, and so you can tell, you know, how old it's supposed to be. It's structured. The stuff that's underneath it is not structured very well. And what structure it has is the kind of structure that could be made from just mashing stuff together and heating it. And so granite does not have an inherent age for when it was formed, unless you want to trust the various methods of radiometric dating. If you do, then I think you have to put this stuff at 35 million years, in which case your problem just got worse. But the idea is that you can make this stuff below, okay, by just jamming stuff together and heating it and recrystallizing it. You can't make the limestone that way. So the current belief is that the limestone was at the bottom of a sea. To be specific, the Tethys Sea, which used to be between India and Asia until it was uplifted. And that's probably actually correct. The problem is that there isn't enough material on top. In order to get that, you have to have about 21 kilometers of rock. Now, think about it. The Grand Canyon, where you can see a huge amount of material, is only about 1 mile, which is like 1.2 kilometers. Probably if you added everything from Brian Head on down, you'd probably get maybe about 2 or 3 miles. Yeah, 5 kilometers. How in the world can you erode 20 kilometers off the top and still leave some limestone? The math doesn't work out.
I might point out this is a basic problem. It's not just Everest that's involved in this.
But Everest is just a really good example
make the point. It's really good because, of course, it's the highest mountain there is. But
and also, we have more precise measurements than you do for some other places. Not all, but some.
Yeah. These figures, you know, you do take them with a certain amount of salt. But Alps are supposed to be going up about 1 millimeter per year. Rockies, 10 millimeters per year. These are figures about, well, read my chapter 15, my book Origins. It's all kinds of data there.
And by the way, the Rocky Mountains are made out of granite at the top, most of them, if I remember correctly.
Right, right.
So that you can kind of see. You know, you're jamming stuff together. It comes up, you erode off all of the sediments that used to go over it, and now you've got granite. But the Alps have still got limestone on them.
And you've got all this younger sediments lower down in the Rockies and these other mountains where it didn't get eroded, where they didn't erode down to the granite.
Yeah.
The slopes.
If we wanted to, you could claim that that's because the Rockies are higher, so they get more erosion, and the other stuff is down lower where it gets less erosion.
Right.
I'm not sure whether you can actually make that claim justifiably, but at least it's kind of plausible.
Erosion is faster in higher elevations than it is in the plains. No question about that.
Yeah.
That's been well measured.
And see, that's the thing. Mount Everest is the highest mountain on Earth, so it should have some of the highest erosion.
Appalachians, 2-3 millimeters supposed to be rising. Andes, figures are kind of mixed on the Andes and so on. The Southern Alps in New Zealand, what is it, 17 millimeters per year and so on. You know, you got all kinds of figures out there.
That's 1.7 centimeters, which is starting to range into the higher.
But they're all way too fast to accommodate in the standard geological time scale. The issue becomes interesting when you look at the total erosion of the continents of the world. And in the
70 years ago, it's getting older the longer we live.
A few geologists all of a sudden realized, hey, erosion is way too fast here. What's going on? And you'll find three references in my book, at least, to that, where they're talking about And they're using the figure that they had from erosion of rivers now. And they measured all the rivers of the world, 12 different studies. Usually they skip the dissolved stuff. Some of them adjust for the bed load by just adding 10% to the suspended load, and so on. But anyway, these are figures that vary between, I think it's 8,000 million tons per year to 58 million tons a year. But these 12 studies, you average them, it comes out to about 25 million tons of material being washed from the continents into the ocean. And so the question, when they looked at this figure here, the question came up, hey, how come the continents aren't all washed away? Because the figure comes to a 61 millimeters per thousand years,
which is 0.6. 61, that would be 0.061 millimeters per year, which is way less than what we're seeing in the Himalayas. But it's still enough to completely erode the continents away.
But our continents are supposed to be, 2.5 billion years old, and 3 billion years old at least. And so the question, how come we aren't all in the ocean now, because everything should have been washed away? And that's recognized there. It remains as an unsolved problem, except some of us have been pointing it out to others, that our continents should have been eroded away, according to those figures, probably 250 times during their geologic age, and they're still here. You want to correct for agriculture. Agriculture speeds up, and the older figures were, maybe it doubles erosion rates. Some more recent studies point out that, no, those figures were based on recycling, and they weren't measuring what was going into the ocean. They were just measuring what was being eroded locally. And so it's less than a half. But even you can make, a statement can be made very safely that our continents should have been eroded at least 100 times in their proposed age. They're still here. What do the geologists say? Well, the reason that they're still here is that they're being renewed from below. And this is the standard answer. They're being renewed from below. Material, the stuff wash away, but it's renewed in the famous rock cycle, where sediments and granite are supposed to, and the match is not good in the rock cycle. I won't get into that right now. But there's no question that, and this is one of the strongest arguments against radiometric dating in the age of all these old layers. How come they're still here? If you should have been washed away 100 times, how come most of that geologic column is right there, from Ordovician up here, but from Cambrian, Precambrian on up, it's still there on the continents. Hasn't been washed away even once, let alone 100 times, let alone 250 times according to present rates. This is a real issue. And I think a fairly strong point that challenges radiometric dating.
Well, I agree with the general conclusions and certainly about erosion and uplift. But we need to be very careful about those early measurements for the height of the summit of Everest. From the first survey of India in about 1895 up until the GPS era, all of the measurements were made from many miles away, triangulation with survey methods, there are lots of sources of error in that those measurements. So even the 1953 measurements are probably quite inaccurate.
I agree with you that I take them with a grain of salt.
Yeah.
The thing of it is that they line up with what our more recent measurements are, and so
yeah.
I tend to be a little less skeptical at that point, because now we have modern rates with GPS that should be pretty accurate.
Yeah, the better measurements are actually from lower on the mountain, where they've actually had a lot more GPS measurements. But that doesn't really speak to the issue of erosion. I mean, if you just look at your picture of the north side of Everest, a lot of erosion can be occurring on the mountain without altering the height of the summit.
True.
So, and to a large extent, that goes on. A lot of it is not constant. It occurs suddenly with avalanches and rockfall and so forth.
That is
just
true.
Like your friend commented on in discussion.
Yeah, but you see, sooner or later that gets to the peak.
Absolutely, I agree.
And that's the problem, is that, you know, we're not talking thousands of years where you could see this thing kind of stabilizing. We're talking millions of years, and by that time it should be grinding down nicely. And that's the thing. For a short age model, it's not actually too bad. You can live with pretty much what you see. For a long age model, well, it's a little bit stickier, and the longer the age, the stickier it gets.
Even for short age models, there's no reason that we need to assume that it was all constant throughout that time.
That's right.
So,
in fact, the interesting thing is the Himalayas are almost all at very near the avalanche angle.
Right.
So that's probably the major. In other words, Mount Everest will probably sit there with his summit there for another 200 years, and then all of a sudden, whoop, and it'll lose 2 feet.
Exactly.
I think we need to point out that it's not just in the short age model, it's not just that you have to adjust. It's implicit in the short age model that things went on much more rapidly at the time of the flood.
I'm wondering about local activities. I've climbed a number of mountains in Washington, like St. Helens, which changed its profile rather radically. And it seems like there are volcanoes going off around the world and changing local factors. So how can you have these constants over millions of years?
There's a section in my chapter 15. Your wife has my book. So
yeah.
look in chapter. It discusses that. As I recall, I think there should be at least, 70 times as much volcanic material out there over geologic time as we find. A major discrepancy there also.
Nick.
Just a minute. Mike's coming down. Oh, well. Now you got
two. I have another question.
Sure.
And that's based on the assumption that, or the fact that the height of Mount Everest is determined by sea level.
Right.
So what's going to happen when Al Gore's prophecy comes true, and Obama says that's the greatest threat to our security, climate change, not what happened in Turkey yesterday, not what happened in France or in our own country, but climate change. So what's going to happen to Mount Everest when the oceans, ocean level rises several meters?
Well, actually, very little will happen to Mount Everest. I suppose that Mount Everest will be now not quite as high above sea level because sea level will have risen. The real problem will be Bangladesh, which will be mostly underwater at that point. The Ganges and Brahmaputra River, that both flow into that big delta, and there's nothing in there that's very high at all. And it will cover that part of the delta if the sea level goes up. So the threat's really to the whole country of Bangladesh rather than to the Himalayas themselves.
How about U.S.?
If their predictions are correct, most of Florida will be underwater.
Most of what?
Florida.
Florida. Okay.
Still not wise to buy land in Florida.
I'm sorry, my...
When?
Well, whenever the glaciers melt enough.
Okay.
So, the interesting thing is that the Himalayas have the largest collection of ice outside of the Arctic and Antarctic. The Arctic, of course, including Greenland, and the Antarctic, including... the continent of Antarctica. The Antarctic glaciers won't make that much difference if they melt because the actual land is below sea level anyway, so that there's a lot of that is almost to a floating stage anyway. But Greenland would be a rather massive dump of ice into the ocean. And that's where they worry about it the most. Again, the Arctic ice cap is irrelevant for this because that is actually floating. And if it were to melt tomorrow, it would make no difference in the height of the sea. The Himalayas have a huge number of glaciers up there. And one of the people who is from India, who is on the... on the climate change panel that writes the books every so often, was claiming that the glaciers would disappear by 2035 or something of that nature, and because they're melting so rapidly. Well, it turns out that the figures he was using were in error, and he wasn't very careful about how he used those figures, and so... that particular claim has had to have been retracted. So, I don't know. There is some melting of some of the glaciers. I know I've been at Athabasca, I think it is, in Canada, where you can see it's gone back a ways. So there is some melting of glaciers. The question is how much. It's important to put numbers to these, and it's even more important to put accurate numbers to these. And unfortunately, people who want to prove a point with numbers are not always really careful to use accurate numbers, which is why I tried to give you all of the numbers that I could reasonably find, and we picked relatively conservative numbers to do our calculations with. Rather than the worst case scenario, you can show it obviously won't work. But I think even in the best case scenarios, you have a problem.
At the risk of measuring the Earth by my lifetime, you talk about sediment in the rivers. Over here in Rubidoux, one year we had heavy rains. I saw huge portions of land disappear in the Amazon jungle as I was traveling by boat down the rivers. I saw huge chunks of bank and huge trees falling into
just
the river.
And gone.
Yes. That's not average. Or how do you average that? Or can you account for the storms over the centuries that have eroded huge amounts rather than small amounts? Your science, even in your book, Origin, leaves me wondering.
That's just fine. Usually these major catastrophes are not taken into account in these figures, which makes the case all the worse. By staying by what we have, you're being conservative, And it's no doubt much more rapid than what's reported because of these major catastrophes.
How do I, as a short age believer, explain all these things? Does it make a difference? How do I, is the erosion on Mount Everest undergird or anything my short age belief?
Well, I think it makes it harder to believe in the standard long age theory, and I think that in itself helps with short age belief. That is to say, there are really two major competing groups of theories, and when one of those theories takes it on the chin, then it makes kind of the other one a little more likely. Now, that of course assumes that somebody is willing to say that the other one is even possible, because there is a phenomenon that you can get that says your theory is so out of it that it doesn't really matter what evidence there is for it. It's not really evidence for it. And this is one way of kind of stonewalling the evidence question completely. So if somebody is committed, there's nothing you can do to reach them. Okay? That'll be God's job. And maybe it's God's job anyway. And so maybe what our job is to be witnesses rather than to be attorneys. That is, we say what we see, you can take it any way you like, and if somebody doesn't want to take it, well, my own feeling is don't fight it at that point. It's not worth fighting. Just, okay, you and I don't see things the same way. That's okay. And then maybe later on it'll start working on them. In fact, that particular method, or an even kinder one, was used to convert two people that I know of, including Dean Kenyon, who was one of the two top people on The Origin of Life. And they said, well, if your theory is, some young lady, as I understand it, came up to him after class and started asking questions, and, you know, how do you explain this and how do you explain this, and never said you're wrong and never said you need your soul saved or anything like that. Just asked him, well, how do you explain this and how do you explain that? And he started giving standard explanations. And as he was giving them, he was an honest enough person to say, no, that's not really a very good explanation. And, he gave it. But, you know, what it did was it allowed the stuff to kind of eat on him. And when it finally came around to it, it ate on him enough to where he said, you know, this just doesn't work. And, of course, if you don't have The Origin of Life, the whole non-interventionist program falls apart. And so he finally just caved in. And interestingly enough, when he caved, he didn't just go to long age with God. He went straight to creationism, because he said, you know, if you're going to have a creator, then the whole explanation without one falls apart, and you might as well go whole hog on it. And a number of people have done that. So it's worth our while to approach things from a very soft point of view. And, you know, if they don't, that's why when I finished that up, I said, that's an interesting explanation. Did you come up with that yourself, or did you read it somewhere? Because I was interested in whether anybody else had given that kind of explanation. He never answered. But, you know.
Yes, he did.
Leave it, and then it eats on him, and then, that, you know, eventually he goes, you know, this doesn't make much sense. Interestingly, he's a design, a believer in design, but he doesn't think that it necessarily points to God, and he's not going to God yet. So, hey, you know, God works with everybody, so just let it go. It's not my job to convert them. My job is to say what I see and then, you know.
I need to know what I know.
Yeah. Well, you know, one of the things you can do after this afternoon is if you have somebody and they're interested, you can point them to this video. And that's one of the purposes of these videos, is so that somebody asks and you don't know, but you've seen it explained and it was explained kind of reasonably, and say, well, look at it and see what you think, and you know, get back to me if you have some specific criticisms of it, because I'm interested in them. And even if you're not really that interested in them, I am, because I don't like to use this kind of thing to you know, to prove a point if it really doesn't prove the point. So if there's a flaw that I'm missing, I'd like to know about it. Now, we had a comment back there? No, he's let it go. Okay. Well, get ready for Graptolites Alive.